Welcome to Babies and Bones. Click to subscribe below.
Don't forget to like and comment. Your comments can guide us on what videos we make next.
Welcome to Babies and Bones. I'm Dr. Kate.
And I'm Dr. Nima. And today we're talking about sleep training made easy and the Ferber method.
So, Kate, what's the idea behind sleep training?
So the idea behind sleep training is providing babies with a window of time to help them acquire the ability to self-soothe.
Okay, when is that window best? What's that window for us?
So typically I recommend parents sleep train their children somewhere between 4 and 6 months. And that's because before 4 months of age, we want babies to know that their parents are a safe place. So when they cry, the parents tend to them immediately. And before that, I think you're messing up with interfering with bonding, and babies won't have like a good sense of security and stuff like that if they're just allowed to cry.
So for the first few months, you want to create a nice bond and a safe place for babies. And then between months 4 and 6, that's the perfect window to allow them to start sleep training.
Yeah, that's the window I recommend. Before four months, they're not really able to self-soothe. And then at 6 months, babies will start to sit up. And it's really hard to sleep train a baby when they keep sitting up and getting upset, because sometimes babies can't figure out how to lay back down. So that 4 to 6 window tends to kind of be the sweet spot. Again, around 4 months, babies don't need to eat in the middle of the night any longer. Most healthy babies are about 13 to 14 pounds around that time. And if they're no longer eating in the middle of the night, and so it's also a good time to do sleep training, because the breastfeeding or formula feeding in the middle of the night can also disrupt the sleep training a little bit.
So it's probably important for you to check with your doctor to make sure it's okay to stop feeding your baby in the middle of the night, and that'd be a good time to start.
Exactly.
Makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. One of the most important things about sleep training is for parents and caregivers to be on the same page. That means the nanny, the grandparents, the parents, they have to have the same routine and do the exact same thing every night. Consistency is key. So if you're using a certain method and the next night they're with the grandparents, it's important that they copy that method. Otherwise, they can really throw that baby off, and the baby will be confused about how to fall asleep and when they should fall asleep, and should they fall asleep alone or in someone's arms, et cetera, et cetera.
Exactly.
So is sleep training necessary?
You know, for some babies, it's really not. I certainly have patients where some of the babies by 8 weeks or by 12 weeks, they're sleeping through the night, and then the parents are no longer feeding in the middle of the night, and everyone's pretty happy. But for the majority of babies, they need a little nudge in order to do the consistent 11 to 12 hours every single night. And so for those families, that's where sleep training is really gonna come into play. And again, for some of my moms who are going back to work around 4 months, when the baby's 4 months of age, they're exhausted. They've been up all night. They're waking multiple times in the middle of the night to help put the baby back down to sleep. And they're going back to work, and they want to perform well at work and kind of impress everybody after coming back after maternity leave. And so it's important for them to get a good night's sleep. And so sometimes this is really what's best for the family unit and not just the baby.
Yeah, so basically what you're getting at is sleep training isn't just for the baby. It's for everyone.
It's for everybody.
Because otherwise, parents can be having poor performance. They can be more irritable, and they can actually be snapping at a child and not be themselves. And it's bad for the entire family.
Exactly. Unit. Yeah, exactly.
So, but with sleep training, is it cruel, like, to let a baby cry or et cetera?
That's a great question. I feel like most people will say that. Like, I'm so worried. Is this going to have long-term anxiety in my child, or fear of abandonment issues and things like that? The answer is no. So there have been long-term studies that have been done, and the research does not support any long-term problems. So there's no increased risk of emotional, physical, psychological, or behavioral disorders in children. And they followed these kids all the way up to about 6 years of age, and there was no real difference between the babies that were sleep trained and the babies that weren't.
So mom, dad, I hope you heard that. That was my wife, who's a pediatrician, who told you it's okay if the baby cries for 1 minute, okay? Just let him be.
Yeah. What it actually does do, though, is the data does show it can improve the rates of maternal depression and also can improve family functioning. So as you kind of commented at before, sleep deprivation can be really, really detrimental to the parents, but also adult sleep deprivation is associated with depression, anxiety, obesity, can be linked to diabetes and to cancer. And so it can be really beneficial for the whole family, as we mentioned before, and not detrimental to the baby.
Oh, that makes a lot of sense. I actually didn't know that. So tell me about what you suggest to your patients or to your friends who ask, what's the best method from all the methods you've read about?
Yeah, so we use the Ferber method with both of our girls. And that's the method I typically recommend for parents.
Our girls.
I think it's more the Ferber method. There's these little kind of check-ins. And so as opposed to just letting your baby cry all night, that's not what the Ferber method suggests. Richard Ferber, who developed this method, he's a sleep specialist, he recommended, it's kind of an idea of progressive waiting. So the baby will cry a little bit and then you go and check in. The baby cries and then you check in. And I liked that method just because you kind of get eyes and you can touch the child. It makes the mom feel and dad feel a little bit better when you're doing the sleep training. And it tends to work in about 3 to 4 nights for most babies.
And the baby doesn't think you're gone. They know because you're checking in, they still know you're around. They don't feel abandoned, right?
Exactly. Okay.
So what's the protocol for that method? What's the time frame?
Yeah, so between 4 and 6 months, you wanna have a consistent bedtime routine. And then when bedtime comes around, you want your child to be tired but awake. So the baby's really sleepy but awake. And instead of rocking the baby to sleep in your arms or having the baby fall asleep with you, you want the baby to be down in the crib, completely awake but very, very tired. And then you say your goodnight or you sing your little song and then you leave the room. And you're leaving the room initially for about 2 minutes. The baby usually will cry because they're not used to just being put down in the crib. And then after 2 minutes, you're allowed to come back in and check on the baby, but you don't want to be in there for longer than maybe a minute to 2 minutes. And the reason for that is because you are not trying to soothe the child. You want the baby to self-soothe. You're just letting the baby know that you're there.
And you're still there.
That you're still there, exactly. And then you leave the room, and then you leave for 5 minutes. If the baby's still crying, you come back in after, you know, if you stay in the room for 1 to 2 minutes, mm-hmm. and then you leave again. And then this next waiting period increases to 10 minutes. And then after 10 minutes, you can go back in again for a maximum of 2 minutes, and then you leave. And then for the first night, you go back in for increments of 10 minutes until the child falls asleep.
Okay.
If that happens again, so that's when you're putting the child to sleep, it happens again in the middle of the night. So normally if the baby were to wake up around 3 o'clock for a feed, 3 a.m. for a feed, instead of feeding the baby, you go in, you don't pick up the baby, you don't rock the baby, you don't feed the baby. Again, maybe a quick pat, a quick I love you for no more than 2 minutes, and then you get out of there, and you do the same thing, the 2 minutes, the 5 minutes, the 10-minute increments, until baby falls asleep in the middle of the night.
Okay, that makes sense. And again, Dr. Nima's key point here is consistency, okay? And that means that everybody's got to do the same thing. So if you're doing this with the baby for a few nights, you can't have someone else take care of the baby for a night while you're at work or if you're gone out of town, and have them switch that routine. Otherwise, we're going to set that baby back, correct?
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. Consistency is really, really key with sleep training. And then with the Ferber method for the second night and the third night, those increments can become longer. So instead of 2, 5, and 10, now you can do 5, 10, 15, 20. The max we did with both of our girls was 20 minutes. Kind of varies depending on the family. It doesn't have to be exactly perfect, but the increments can extend. And then usually by the third or fourth night, the babies wake up on their own. They kind of look around. Sometimes they don't even cry, and then they just kind of go back to sleep because they know that those check-ins are just that. They're check-ins. They're not going to be fed. They're not going to be coddled or rocked. And so they learn how to self-soothe and put themselves back to sleep.
And you've taken care of probably thousands of babies in your career so far. So is it possible to have any method where a baby doesn't cry? Because I know a lot of people want to know that. They look at the no-cry method.
The no-cry sleep method.
Yeah.
I really haven't found something that requires zero crying at all. There are some books out there and sleep trainers and people that have some methods. But in general, for parents who are doing this alone at home, there is going to be just a small amount of crying usually that goes on. It's going to be different between children. Obviously, some kids cry more than others, and some kids are a little bit more persistent than others. But in general, there's a little bit of crying and a little bit of discomfort, but that is just, it's short-lived. It's only for a few nights, and all of a sudden, then you have this baby who's sleeping a lot better and through the night, and again, it's so much better for the baby and the family unit in the long run. You're actually decreasing the amount of crying overall.
Yeah, so again, if you guys have any questions or want to read more about it, look up the Ferber method, and you can read the details, but we gave you a pretty good breakdown. And the most important thing, finally, the take-home message is consistency between caretakers and building a good routine. Actually, I want to leave you one more thought. It's super important to just pay attention to your own family. Don't pay attention to friends who have kids, you know, your kids' age, because it's easy to compare and contrast. But the truth is, every baby's different. And we had a friend whose baby literally was magical and could talk and go to sleep and eat perfectly, and it drove me nuts. Okay, part of the reason why I developed hair loss. But my baby was different. It cried all the time. And thank God Kate was able to help us navigate that. But just pay attention to your own child and don't compare.
No comparing.
I hope you enjoyed this video. And if we left anything out, we sometimes forget things. Please leave it in the comments and tell us what else we can add in next time.
Thanks for listening.
Bye-bye.